Welcome to Inspirational Living with Shonda Jenkins. Are you ready to rediscover you? On this show, I share stories from my own personal experiences, knowledge from spiritual teachers, mindfulness leaders, and philosophers, guiding people to inner healing, self-discovery, and self-love. If you're tired of feeling stuck in cycles from your subconscious programming, or you feel like your life lacks a sense of purpose, tune in today while I share with you another tip on how you can live a more fulfilling, joyful, and purposeful life. Before we get into this episode, I want to share with you guys that I wrote a book. It's called Finding My Happy Place, inspiring you to live a happy life. Finding My Happy Place is meant to inspire you to go on your own journey and free yourself from society beliefs of who you are and who you should be and how you should live your life. I used to struggle with people-pleasing, insecurities, and feelings of unworthiness until one day I decided it was enough. This book is meant to inspire you to get your power back so that you can be the best version of yourself and find happiness in the process. Because each day you wake, when you fill your mind with inspiration, more incredible things will happen for your life. This book is more than inspiration and motivation. It's a self-development book meant to propel you to create the changes you want to see in your life. So are you ready for changing your life? Do you need a daily dose of motivation? And are you ready to be inspired? This book is here to help you live a happier and fulfilled life. The book is available on Amazon. I have paperback for only $10. The hardcover is only $15. And if you have Kindle Unlimited, it's $0 or $5 for the ebook. So if you're ready to live a more happier and fulfilled life, check out my book, Finding My Happy Place, inspiring you to live a happy life. All right, you guys, let's get into today's episode. Welcome back to Inspirational Living. I'm your host, Shonda Jenkins, and this month's theme is about helping you bloom through harnessing resilience, living a more purposeful life, embracing the unknown, or turning your big dreams into a reality. Today, I have with me Jennifer Hirsch, a spiritual reader. She used cryology and palmistry. Today, she's going to be talking about how to live a purposeful life. So welcome to the show, Jennifer.
Hi, thank you so much. So it's just an absolute delight to be here.
Yes, I'm excited to have you here. And Jennifer, will you tell everybody where you're joining me from?
Yeah, I live in a small town on the east coast of South Africa. It's called Ramsgate. It's subtropical. It's exceptionally beautiful. I live on the beach, so I'm very, very fortunate in that regard. And today is a particularly gorgeous day. And the province really of where I live is called KwaZulu-Natal. Many of you will have heard of Jacob Zuma, who was our ex-prime minister. President, and he's from this part of the world as well. Very much the Zulu nation.
Oh wow! I bet you it's nice. You said it is on the beach.
Yep, it's on the beach, and it's really just 2 minutes down onto the beach, and the swimming is glorious, and the beaches go on forever. And especially in between readings and in between teaching. Because I teach cryology and palm reading hand reading has got several names. In America, the popular name is hand analysis. So I personally think that hand reading and hand analysis and cryology and palmistry are all pretty much, you can wrap them up in a very similar bundle.
Okay. And tell us about, you said what now?
I was saying that when I'm finished teaching, usually then I'll go onto the beach, and that's a very beautiful way to ground, just to stabilize and center and recoup the energy. And I feel very fortunate for that.
Yeah, I definitely want to live on a beach, but my husband doesn't want to live on a beach.
Tell us a little bit about what you do when you are hand reading, like kind of about what that is.
Okay, so the normal process, this is pre-COVID in a sense, and that is that the client arrives and we take a set of palm prints with ink, which is a it's a water-soluble ink, so it washes off super easily, and we get an impression of the hands, and then we do the reading based on the, what the hand features showing me. And actually, hand reading, contrary to popular understanding or perception, is that is not just about the lines. We're looking at so much more than the lines. We're looking at the shape, skin texture, the thumb quite specifically, the shapes of the fingers, the mounts, which are the fleshy protuberances around the hands, and very importantly, also the dermatoglyphic patterns, which obviously are our fingerprints, as well as what we see in the patterns in our palms. So it's quite comprehensive in terms of the overview of the hand. And then we also look at like what people do with their hands, how much gesticulation is there, and or do they hide their hands? So there's like, it's very deep and very multifaceted. And we get talking, we just simply talk. It's just about sitting down and unwrapping and uncovering and really digging around a little bit in, with some inquiry questions, quite carefully thought out and perceived in the hands as well. One can see things like, say, emotional pain or physical weakness, and we get into the conversation like that. And then since COVID, just quickly to share, and that is that now people send the photographs of their hands. So it's mostly online, so it's like changed a bit, but we work amazingly well from photographs as well.
Oh, wow. I was wondering, how do you do it when someone is not there? And you said photographs, so that's, I was like, do they have ink?
There are some hand readers that when a client contacts them from far, they send them an ink sheet. It's a kind of I don't have one here to show you, but it's a sort of an A4 size, approximately slightly smaller than A4, it's an ink sheet with a transparency over it, and you just pull that off and you take your own palm prints and then submit them back to the reader. So there's several readers around the world that use that system. Mm. I don't like those ink sheets though, because they're very difficult to get the ink off.
Mm.
And then people who don't know how to take palm prints, it's not that easy. One needs to practice a bit. So photographs are very adequate.
Yeah. So how long have you been doing this? Like what caused you to get into palm reading and stuff like that?
Again, at the very end of 1990, I had my first palm reading. And that was 33 years ago now almost. But straight after that, I started studying with the same man that read my hands. That was in Johannesburg. And I studied with him for 6 months. And then very sadly, he died. And then I joined the British Chirological Society, which at the time, they're now defunct, but at the time were kind of the hand reading school in the world, one can say, pretty much, especially outside of the States.
Yeah.
And their home study course, and then they very quickly appointed me as their South African representative. So I was really in the right place at the right time.
Yeah. Wow. That is amazing. So it's like he left and then you kind of took on from his legacy, basically.
That's a thought. Although I went a little more psychological than him. He was very gypsy oriented.
Yeah.
So okay. Because the old way that people understand palmistry is that it's chronological. There's the past and there's the future, and the present sort of hovers around somewhere in between. But the way I like to read and the way I've been taught to read is much more holistic. It's more qualitative. In other words, we're concerned with the whole person. So obviously formative influences and the impact that those influences will have on a future. And the likelihood of that future, but rather than predict a definitive outcome of a future, much more important to equip the person with tools for all possible eventualities. So we avoid disempowering people in any way, if that makes sense.
Yes, because at least from watching like movies, is always like something like bad is gonna happen or whatever. And that's disempowering. And then you're not gonna know what to do after that. If you feel like your life is already not going to turn out like you want it to.
This is exactly, and you have no idea how many stories I've heard of the most horrific, unethical, dangerous, and distressing stuff that people have been told when they go and see palm readers.
Mm.
So I think I've just been born into this purposeful life, if you like, talking about it a little bit.
Yeah.
To do my little bit that I can possibly do to debunk the myths around that you can foretell length of life, that you can tell how many children, that you can tell if there's going to be divorce. I mean, to some extent you can, but that's already going into a little bit of a gray zone, because obviously there's free will and there's the other person in the equation.
Yes.
There's a lot more to it than a simple black and white, you know, you're going to get terrible disease one day, which is, I've heard that being said.
Oh my gosh. So let's get into,
their three children. Can you imagine such a thing?
Yeah.
Conceivable. Yeah.
So these are people who came to you. They said this, like clients. That is crazy.
They came to me and then they were told it by other readers that they went to.
Mm.
And I think that's why, because of the fear of palmistry and the collective consciousness, you know, and the psyche, it's like it's an archetype and it's terrifying that, you know, that the gypsy be able to sort of see into your life and do all these woo-woo things and that's why so few people practice this as well. It's as I wrote in one of my articles, it's feared by many and practiced by few.
Mm. Wow. And is it because of them giving the wrong predictions or?
Well, yeah, that very, very much. And then it's also feared, or rather resisted, by a lot of people because of the responsibility, which obviously ties in to the projected perception of the client. Mm-hmm. So the client comes along and they almost expect me to be like perfectly psychic and to know exactly, especially if they're expecting outcome conversation.
Yeah.
And my role is to educate that this is chirology. I call it, and this has been my mission statement from like 30 years ago, let's say, because that's when I really seriously started to practice it. And that is that chirology is a bridge between divination and psychology.
Mm.
That's really something that I like, or psychology and divination, if you prefer. Because it is, it's a dialogue therapy. It's a therapy. It's not just a bunch of silly small talk that, you know, party tricks.
Yeah.
You know, we're holding hands for starters, especially under normal circumstances, we'd be holding hands, very intimate, gazing into each other's eyes. I mean, it doesn't get more intimate than that.
Yeah.
The reason people aren't that keen to do it, because it takes courage.
Yeah. Yeah, looking into somebody's eyes and talking to them, some people might not be able to do that.
Yeah, well, exactly. I mean, I promise you, I don't know if you can see from there, but I've literally had clients where they'll sit like this, the whole body language, the hand
is, oh my God,
out the door almost. I have had that experience as well, where there's the willingness to be there along with the absolute fear and resistance. And yeah, because also one has to speak your truth. I mean, that's why they come, and then sometimes they don't like what I say.
Yeah. So. Wow. Mm. So through all of this, like, let's talk about how to live the purposeful life and how you've been able to harness that.
Thank you. Yeah. Sort of by default, you know, I don't think I landed in this lifetime with consciousness around living on purpose, but I've been incredibly blessed to have found a life purpose and to have been able to really shape it into a vocation. So I'll tell you a little bit about my story, maybe that'll help.
Yeah.
And what happened is that when I was 16, I dropped out of school. And there were a lot of reasons for that, family dynamics and just not so much happiness, as you can imagine. And then when I was 17, I fell pregnant and had my child. I did get married to the father, but there was a lot of trauma, like year after year after year, and struggling along to survive and doing many, many different types of jobs. But somewhere deep in my heart, I always knew that healing was my life purpose. And when I was 26, eventually, after all sorts of trials and errors, I became a massage therapist. And I did that very professionally for many, many years. And many people, thousands of bodies, rubbed thousands of bodies. And that gave me the opportunity really to do my healing work and to also have the conversations. And now, while all this was going on in my life, I was going in and out of therapy a lot. So yeah. I don't have an official qualification as a psychologist. I kind of learned a lot about psychology, and I've done plenty of courses in between, you know, more like, like Lifeline and, you know, a few other, you know, lay courses, one could say. Mm-hmm. And I started harnessing and gathering knowledge, and I like to think of it as wisdom at this stage, that through all my life experiences and my mistakes and so on, I kept retreating to my work, or like leaning into my work, because my work became such a sanctuary. And I think with living purposefully, that one needs to make a choice around some kind of place that you go to that is sacred for you.
Yeah.
When you're in that task, you lose time, space. And not to expect some kind of permanent orgasm, you know.
That's yeah.
But it's more like that 1% tipping point, that you keep breathing life into it. Just say, just do it. Just do it. Just do it. Just do it. Even if you so burnt out and you don't want to ever look at another set of hands or rub another body or do another interview or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Person, when you're looking for life purpose, it's not going to be an incredible aha. I've been struck forward by God with a thunderbolt of lightning and this is my purpose. It's not like that. It's a choice. So, but the tipping point needs to be there.
Yeah. I think that's what people think is going to be, like this lightning bolt that goes off and like, and then the birds start singing, this is the best thing ever. But I guess it's going to that deeply. Why do you think that people think it's supposed to be like that? I guess your perspective.
that's a very interesting perspective on it. There's a lot of components to why people, that's a form of resistance.
Yeah.
It doesn't quite grab me enough, or I got bored with it, or I tried it, but it didn't work for me. You know, I've heard that so many times, because lots of people do come to me for vocational counseling.
Yeah.
And, you know, looking for their life purpose, it's one of the biggest things that people come for with their hands. What do my hands tell me? What can you tell me from my hands about what I'm born for?
Yeah.
So the resistance is partly that feeling of, the resistance is the inability to be disciplined. Because discipline definitely comes into the mix, don't you think?
Yes. I think with anything, even if you think it's this, you know, moment where it came to you, you still have to be disciplined to actually do it. Because if you're not disciplined, you can't really make anything come to fruition.
Exactly. And the discipline is what gives us freedom. You know, that's that oxymoron, isn't it? The more responsibility, the more freedom. So there's that. And then there's also kind of a payoff in being a victim, or, you know, sounds a bit harsh, but that people also unconsciously, because we all of us, and myself included, very much in my life, have been stuck in self-pity. And that's a very wounded place to be. It's not that it's a wrong place to be. It's more like that when you're enacting one of the seven types of self-pity that I understand or exist, there are seven factors to various types of self-pity. And if you're in one of those, you're hurting deeply. And from that platform of hurt, there is an inability to stand up and nourish yourself and take a stand for your own joy.
Yeah.
And then there's the deservability that comes into that mix there as well. I don't actually deserve to be anybody because I'm just so shame-based, for example. Or my husband will leave me. If I become a somebody in a chosen profession, the status quo in my family dynamic is going to shift. And that's a big fear for people.
Yeah, definitely. Because that's the one thing people want, connection. And if you feel like you're not going to have it, then you're more likely to not go towards what you want to do. Because that's a feeling of rejection.
It's a fear. It's all fear-based, I think. I mean, you could say some people are lazy, I suppose. There is that, or they're in their comfort zone. I keep using like quite judgmental sounding concepts here, but I think that's just comfort zone. Comfort zone is swimming in your own little back pond, even though it's stagnant and uninspiring or uninspired, it's safe. And that, I think, is another reason why people don't move towards being on purpose.
Yeah. Probably because they want to stay safe. Yeah. I can definitely say there's times where I didn't want to do things because, of course, fear of the outcome. Even with cutting my hair, I recently cut my hair, and you know, the mental chatter of what people will think. And I realized that people are usually going to embrace you for doing something for yourself. And that is something I have to remind myself when I'm making decisions, is that they're going to embrace you for you being you. And I think that's what we have to get out of our head. And once we do it, people are more embracing.
Absolutely. I just love your hair.
Thank you.
Catching on it and thinking, wow, it's so cool. Like a pixie look. I love it.
Thank you.
So, you know, it's really, I think people are not really responding so much to the visuals. It's much more to the soul essence here.
Yes. Yes, definitely.
A reason to move towards living a life on purpose is sometimes very much just to shift gear a little bit. Just came to me now, and that was where I was kind of going with my story, and that is that I came to hand reading also because I needed to make money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was a massage lady. I was doing all of these massages, but I was getting older. I'll be 70 this year, you know. It was like, I knew that I've been bodies all my life.
Yeah.
So that was a big motivation. And that's something that I sometimes like to promote. And that is that you can earn income from doing this work, even though you do not have a qualification as a psychologist or any other kind of therapist. It offers a platform for natural born coaches, natural born counselors to be available to people.
Yeah. And the book that we're going to talk about today, we haven't even talked about it. So tell me about Tam's book and tell everybody the name of it and kind of how that book, has that book been helpful for you? Is something that you use or?
Oh yeah, I've actually written 6 books, and this book is, I've got it here. I'll just show it to you. There it is, looking a bit tatty, but it's full color and it's got hundreds of tutorials with hundreds of photographs or images rather. And I use my own books all the time. That's the crazy thing. Even I don't remember all the possible meanings for each marking, which is interestingly, you don't have to have like an, you know, photographic memory.
Yeah.
You clients are very happy if you turn to your books. They don't mind if you look up something while they're sitting with you.
Okay.
So that's the book that Tam very excitingly has taken into her shop.
Yeah.
And she now vends it on my behalf. She's published it in the States, which I'm very excited about.
Yeah.
And I think it's my best book. That's why her and I decided that's the one to start with. And of course, it's available in her shop page. I've got the URL if you or anyone else wants it.
Okay, yeah. What's the URL?
She's offering a discount on the book as part of our chat today, just saying.
Oh, wow. Okay, tell everybody URL. Then I'm going to put it in the chat also.
All right. Well, I'll have to send it to you in the chat, shall I?
Yes.
I'll just have to pick it up. Hold on one secky. I don't have my glasses. There we go.
So it's spirituallymindful.store/product-illustrated-chronology-palm-tree-and-handwriting. So is this something that someone else can take and actually start reading their own hands, or?
Yes, definitely. Definitely. I mean, there's a little bit of work involved, as there always is, kind of thing. But actually, you know what? If people want to start with their own hands, I do have another recommendation, and that is that at my website, there's a free PDF download that you can get on my homepage that tells you about how to interpret the fingerprint, or rather the thumbprint on your thumbs.
Yeah.
The fingerprint on your thumb, the dematic glyph. And believe it or not, our skin ridge patterns, our glyphs, I call them, dematic glyphics, fingerprints, are very interestingly being incorporated into the hand reading systems in more modern hand reading. So in the old years, prior to maybe, say, the 50s even, there was almost no mention of fingerprints in any of the old literature. And then gradually it started to sort of seep in, and then it became a thing. It's like our fingerprints, like they are a feature of our individual identity, they also tell you about your character, like specific character traits. And how it works is that they are allocated an element rulership. So you've got earth, water, fire, air, and ether. And as we know, earth has certain principles and characteristics, like earth is stable, steady, supportive. And then you'll know that a person with that particular dramatic glyphic will have those traits of steady, stable, and supportive. We define the unknown, which is the hand, in terms of the known, which is the element, the principles, the scientific principles of the elements.
Oh, wow.
So it's a beautiful system, actually, and very easily learned. And the minute they've read through that part of the book, then it should be like pennies dropping, and then they can compare the lines and. Yes.
Oh, wow. Okay. So if someone wants to get into this, they can really just start with just reading your books. Yeah. Awesome.
I'd like to think so, definitely. And then on left-handedness and gestures, gypsy reading, I think is in this book. It's definitely in one of my other books. Psychic stuff, intuition, prediction, like a little tutorial on each topic that I've tried to cover.
Oh, so what do you think could be the first thing that someone could do to start living like a more purposeful life? Because I know that this kind of fell into your lap, kind of how you discovered it. But for someone else that, you know, didn't have the same story as you, how can you help them with getting to living a more purposeful life? Like, where could they start?
To start. So There are a few criteria to talk about here, really. I'm sure you and your listeners have heard of the ikigai, the Japanese concept. Okay.
There we go. We can start.
So the ikigai is, it's like basically a diagram, and the diagram is defined by what you're good at, what you enjoy doing, what the world needs, very important, and what can earn you money. So there are four components to being on purpose. And the money thing is part of it because there's an energy exchange. So,
yes.
So you are choosing those four criteria as your guidelines in terms of ultimately the decision, the capital D, that you make.
Yeah.
In to find out, I suppose, prior to that, even what makes you feel happy, like where's your joy, like where do you feel that you in something that you are in a good space while you're doing it.
Yeah.
And then again, not to expect too much. Don't be too idealistic. Don't be too exacting. Because it's never like that. You know, it's like it becomes better and better the more life, it being one's mission, life mission, becomes better the more you breathe life into it. It becomes more alive.
Yeah.
I know, you know.
I think that's what a lot of people have to get over. I actually had someone tell me, they said, I don't really know what I like doing. I don't really know what I like. I was like, what do you have fun doing? It was like, I don't really do anything.
Well, that does happen.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have actually had several people see me who are in that. And then you wonder, you know, is there some kind of a low-grade depression? There could be that, or a few of the factors I mentioned earlier around the unconscious sort of benefit, even though it's very kind of unpleasant, like not very beneficial actually, but you know, there's some kind of perception that they are safe. So there is that, but thank goodness that's less common than with people who say, no, well, I do like sewing. I quite like it when I sew. Okay, well, what else? Well, you know, I quite like walking dogs for supporting the animal welfare. Okay. And you start making like a little list of maybe five things that for you are pleasing activities.
Okay.
Even if it's gifts or whatever, you know, it could be any jolly thing. And then you do your homework and you start, if you're really motivated to live on purpose and to find something that gives you a sense of purpose that you get, or that you're going to offer yourself the gift of
yes,
a purpose, is that you're going to pick one of those five after maybe journaling a bit about each of them and looking at the pros and cons and, you know, doing a, you know, two-sided sheet of paper and the positives and the negatives. I mean, I really believe in doing that a lot, like downloading.
Yeah.
And do it over a period of time. It doesn't have to be immediate. And then make the call. And then you stay on the narrows. You just stay on the path and you just do it. You just do it day after day after day, every day, a little bit, every day.
Yeah.
And eventually things stop, magic happens. It's like alchemical, really. And you dream about it, you have to dream, because dreaming is the sacred feminine side, and that's where the real stuff happens.
Yeah.
Is in the non-material realms.
Yeah. So that dreaming part is definitely something you should be thinking about every day, as like, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. So yeah, I think that's very important, because it kind of puts you into you actually doing it. Like, you're kind of telling yourself, I'm doing it, even though you're not quote unquote doing it. So yeah, I believe in dreaming, visualization, because I think those are very helpful, because your mind thinks in pictures. So.
Absolutely, definitely agree 100%. Make a collage, do a mind map, imagine your logo, imagine what words you might want to have in your calling card, learn some basic tech, because whether you like it or not is part of how it's the important, you know, how we have to be in the world today is to be able to get visible. That's tough. That's a big block for a lot of people, actually, unfortunately.
Yeah, because it's shifting from the old way to doing things this new way, and it's embracing technology is already difficult. Then have to embrace it in with your business or what you want to do, because even with careers, you have to embrace technology.
This is true.
Yeah.
There's so much fear. You know, you can't just be a, you know, therapist on any level these days.
Yeah.
It's just not that anymore. There's a hustle involved somehow.
Yeah.
Maybe not for some, but for the most part.
Yeah. Well, so I really like that you said to do a mind map. Also, you told them to really write down five things and brainstorm stuff that they feel like they're good at, and what they can actually make money with too, because that's important. So is there anything else you feel like people could benefit from outside of that? Just start doing it.
Well, it would depend on what it is that that person feels some attraction to. Mm-hmm. So if it's to do with counseling and coaching, which is essentially what hand reading is,
mm-hmm.
and you feel like you want to do some form of counseling and coaching, but you're not sure perhaps if it's going to be hand reading, but you could either simply go and learn to do coaching, because there's plenty of coaching courses. And they're even counseling courses, of course. And then you could consider one of the other ologies, which is actually what I did. You know, it did take quite a lot of thinking for me, because, you know, did I want to do graphology, which is, of course, the study of handwriting? Or did I want to do astrology or numerology or kinesiology? And I went through all the ologies, psychology, and then psychology. Yes, if I hadn't dropped out of school, I would have definitely gone into psychology, because that's my gift, no doubt about it. That's where I seem to be able to hold on to the threads of what people present in a consultation, and then somehow help to integrate them before they leave. Say so myself. I think that's something that I'm gifted with. So anyway, I couldn't go back to school. I had my children. By then I'd had two more children, and then it was like, I can't imagine myself going the sort of mainstream educational system and doing psychology. And then it came out that I could do it anyway through this beautiful hand reading system.
Yeah. So even just going through the list of things is also important for people, so that you can know which one that really is going to be the one that you like the most.
Yeah. And then to, even if it's, like I often tell people, because of the emphasis on downloading, so these inspirations, these ideas, they come sometimes for a lot of us in the mornings after we've slept. There's that beautiful saying, the day gives back so much more than the night. It's the other way around again. The night gives back so much more than the day takes away. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Morning, and then there's this just like this epiphany of like, that could be a plan, and you go and you write it down, even if it's one word, that somehow that word is an important word for you in the context of whatever it is that you're interested in. That is a gesture to God, to your soul, by whatever name, that it's like you're asserting that you aligned with going towards something. You're going towards yourself, essentially.
Yeah.
You're moving yourself by doing something like that.
Okay. So even the downloads can be helpful for us.
Yeah.
I get my downloads in the most randomest times when I'm busy. It's like, are you really wanting? I don't have a piece of paper. So I definitely think it's important to listen to those downloads, because they can be downloads for you, or I feel like also they could be for someone else too, like maybe giving them advice, or if you have children, it could be for them. So yeah, paying attention to those downloads.
Pay attention to downloads. That's so special and beautiful. Yeah, and a lot. Because we've forgotten around about alchemy and about magic and the mysteries of what's really going on in our world here. Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of, it's not like a let go, let God entirely, because there's that balance between the doing and the being, but there definitely needs to be some kind of right brain activity that goes with the doing. Whether it's an art endeavor or music or cooking or something where you're not thinking too much.
Yeah.
In the space that gives you spaciousness. There's this beautiful concept as well that I learned from another coach lady from England. And she spoke about offering your sacred bundle. Mm. And such a gorgeous idea. I think that it's like having a toolkit, but it's more than that. It's something more special than that. It's like more soulful, it's from the heart. It's like, what is in your sacred bundle? Each person listening today, what is your, and whatever's in there, it might just be being a gran and you know, being available to the grandchildren. And that's enough.
Yeah.
And it could be enough. And those ingredients can keep shape shifting. You know, maybe tomorrow you're going to bake cookies or knit a jersey or something. I'm being silly now, but it's, that is the way to authentically be in the world. Like, check in with yourself, what's in my sacred bundle? And then be authentic in the way you offer it.
Yeah.
Like, being in service and getting ourselves out of the way is, it's just the only way now. I think we all know that. I mean, it's these days. It's like we can't put money as the motivator. It doesn't work. This really doesn't work. I'm telling myself that a lot, because obviously we have to survive and all of that. But the less we think about that and just keep offering our sacred bundle, then existence takes care.
Because it's really sometimes difficult not to think about the money aspect of things, because we know that's how we have to live. You know, we have to pay our bills, we have to buy food. But understanding, if we keep offering our sacred bundle, that everything will be taken care of.
Well, yeah, that's that's very challenging.
Yeah, it's easy said than done, right?
It's like being in integrity with yourself.
Yeah.
I recently did an incredible course with a psychologist in Cape Town. Her name's Eilat Eviram, just mentioning her name quickly. But she teaches a beautiful course for all healers of any form. I mean, she's qualified and she gets like a lot of doctors and psychologists and stuff in her groups. But anyway, the point is that the workshop was called, How to Love Yourself in Your Decisions. That was what it was.
Okay.
The book is called, If I Love Myself Now, What Would I Do?
Oh, wow.
If I love myself, what would I do now? I'm not exactly sure of the words. But anyway, it's all about one of her little kind of mottos is, with every decision you make, are you moving towards yourself or are you moving away from yourself?
Mm-hmm.
You go to the fridge and you decide what to eat. Are you moving towards yourself or away from yourself?
Oh, wow. I'm writing it down. Because I think that could help us all. Like, if we just take that moment before we make a decision, ask ourselves, are we moving towards ourselves or farther away? It really will help us, like, get closer to where we want to go.
So true. Yeah. And if you're going to move away from yourself by buying those chocolates or whatever, when you know that your body doesn't deal well with them, then just take a moment with yourself as well. And well, it's the same. Okay, let's bring it back into the context of living purposefully. let's say a day has gone by and you haven't even hardly given your life purpose a thought, you got distracted, you whatever. And it's like you're lying in bed at night and you're sort of beating up on yourself a bit, you know, I'm not making any effort and I'm not going to get anywhere like this and I'm still so stuck and whatever critical inner voice. And then to say, okay, well, just take a moment here. Let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater. Have some compassion for yourself. And the next morning when you wake up, you journal and you do some downloading and then you can get back on track again.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so many courses. There's Udemy, there's many online type places where you can do like really inexpensive little courses that can just give you that bit extra knowledge on whatever it is that interests you and bit by bit by bit.
Yeah. I really like that. So definitely the course at Udemy is definitely a great site to use to get started if you are on a budget. And they have everything. Everything you could think of.
They do everything.
Yeah.
I know what your morning kind of ritual or process is like, but for me personally, that's my best time, quiet of the morning. So if anyone who's looking to live purposefully is able to just get their bum in the chair of whether it's at the computer or whatever it is that they do, then it does start to flow in the early mornings usually. That's another thought.
No, the mornings are, I have a whole routine for my morning. So I definitely think that if you are going to do anything, you know, starting with your morning, because if you start in the morning, you kind of, I have to look at it as like, I got it out the way. Because I know if I try to do it later in the day, it might not happen, but if I do it in the morning, I know I got it out the way and that I don't feel bad later on if it doesn't get done.
Like your yoga and meditation.
Yes, to my meditation. Because if I skip it, it's probably not going to get done later. So I'd rather do it in the morning and do my exercise and then it's done. And honestly, sets the tone for my day. When I don't do it, then I can tell because my day gets chaotic.
That morning process is so key, I think, to happiness. I don't think there's a single spiritual teacher or coach or any influencer out there who doesn't promote that.
Yeah.
Of using your morning time in a sacred way in some way.
Yeah. That's gonna really help you with getting on track for your purpose for life, because it really starts with you working with you first.
Yeah. And choose one thing.
Yes.
I did with hands. It was like, okay, this is, I can make this work. And believe in yourself.
Yeah.
And then offer it generously. That's the other thing. I think that's really important these days. Well,
yeah.
You know, with all marketing systems as well, they say be like crazy generous. And even if there are 10 other kids on the block doing the same thing,
yes,
I'd love to go into promoting gifts, selling beautiful gifts for Christmas or whatever. And then all these other people, oh, you know, I'm feeling like demoralized because, you know, I discovered that around the corner there's no. It's like you are going to be uniquely you in what it is that you offer. And there's always enough to go around.
Yeah.
It's never a competition.
I think that's the fear of it's not enough, the scarcity. When you see other people, at least I'll say for myself, you start thinking like, oh, it's not enough to go around, but really it is enough to go around.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. So you have shared, what are you about to say?
I was about to say that for people who are like feeling really, really stuck and they don't have any interests at all, that warrants some therapy, someone who's kind of insightful and compassionate and can really get to the root of what happened that you became stuck in this impasse within yourself. What trauma maybe?
No, I think that's important, because sometimes when I hear that, I don't really know what's the next thing, because I know for myself how to do it. But when someone else feels like they're stuck, maybe I can like offer them to like go talk to a counselor. Maybe they can kind of help you open up and kind of figure out like what is what you want to do. Because we all have a purpose, I feel like, here on this earth.
Oh, for sure. Sometimes I'm just thinking of one particular client at the moment, funnily enough. It's just, I thought that this girl was, she was just locked in a rage, but she was sweet and soft and everything, and she was crying a lot, but there was so much anger in her. And I think that that sometimes that could be what paralyzes some people, along with a whole host of other possibilities, of course. But,
Just letting that be, let that out, because that could be preventing you from what you want to do, or even thinking about what you can do.
And the terror of feeling one's feelings can be, yeah, just like crippling. It just makes you paralyzed. Yeah.
Yeah. Your mind. Our mind can stop us for so many things. It was, I think it was a quote. It said, my life changed when I changed my mind. And I was like, definitely, because our mind often prevents us from doing so many things because of this internal chatter about how it's going to turn out, or no one's going to support you, or you can't do that. And it's not really our own thoughts, because our thoughts, if our thoughts are turning us down, then it's probably not thoughts from ourselves.
Yeah, I'd agree. The mind is such a torture chamber, actually. So, I mean, I think it's like the, well, this is going a bit deep, but there's that almost like it's the shadow, essentially. It's like that part that wants our demise, you know, that doesn't want us to be successful and joyful. It wants us to suffer. And we all have that negating the dragon, or whatever, by whatever metaphor you want to use there, that we have to slay. Yeah, sure. And then for me, because now at one point when I first moved to the sea here, I just wanted to stop working, because I also do mosaicing, and I wanted to just stick to my mosaic art and just give it up with the hands and not do readings and not teach. And I went through a little phase of that. And then I was getting less and less happy. And one morning I woke up and I thought, no, 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 no. I did a complete 180. It's like I changed my mind. And since then I got myself a coach, and I've got my website really beautiful now. And I've written a whole bunch of new PDFs on all sorts of interesting topics. I'm back on YouTube. Slowly, slowly, I'm actually building, and I'm doing the Instagram daily and so on. And slowly now I'm building my life mission, which is more like a vocation, I feel now, which is bridging the gap between divination and psychology through the medium point of departure of palmistry or chirology. Yeah. And what else do you do as you grow older? I mean, you've got to do something. Otherwise, you just get old and the brain starts to atrophy and all of that. I do recommend for older people to get their teeth into something, definitely.
Don't really sit around, just do something.
I live in a complex here, and I'm pretty much the only person who works. And it's like the other people they're so bored and stuck, and they live a beautiful life on the outside, but there's not a lot of joy.
Wow. I do believe that you need to work. And it doesn't have to be hard work, where it's on your body hard, but it could be, something, because we're supposed to be using this thing all the time. Our mind. Otherwise, I feel like a lot of older people, they get older because of not doing anything, or just sitting on the rocking chair or whatever they might be doing. And I think it's really important to keep moving yourself and in your mind, because that's what we're here to do.
And to be available and to help others is so key as well. And make something your purpose. Just make, doesn't matter, it can be anything, but consciously make it your purpose, even if it is being a grandmother. Because being on purpose, it's just a sensation at the end of the day. It's an in the moment sensation. It's not some sustainable, I'm always feeling that my life is perfectly on purpose. There's always that probably like 49% bread and butter grind in whatever gig you're doing.
Yes.
Yeah. Even in the most glamorous jobs.
Yeah. Just consciously making it your purpose is more fulfilling. And I have never had anybody break that down like you did.
Okay, thank you. You got me thinking.
No, I really think that's important. You said what?
You ever had your palms read?
No, I haven't.
Oh my gosh, one can't see too well, but lovely hands.
Thank you.
Ooh, but I can notice straight away. You notice if you have a look at your hands, face them to the Seki, then if you have a look on the edge of your baby finger, there's a little jut. You see that? It like juts outside.
Yeah.
Now that ledge is very significant. I mean, I can actually see so much more now, but let's start with that. That little ledge broadens the so-called Mercury mount, which is the little mount underneath the baby finger.
Oh, and it
adds to the mental kind of engagement of the owner of that set of hands. So Mercury being the messenger of the gods in the old mythical tradition. So again, we define the unknown, which is your hand, in terms of the known, which is the myth.
Yeah.
And it's true that you have a very active mind, that your mind cannot easily relax, that meditation would be really, really, really important for somebody like you. And there we have it.
Wow. So, yeah. Meditation is important for me.
Exactly. So just based on a little angle of the hand here, there's a whole story, and that applies for, you know, the whole outer kind of image of the hand. One, for example, in my hands, I've got these massive thumbs here.
Yeah. You see?
Yeah, they jut out significantly. Yeah, you've also got it.
Yeah.
Okay. So good. So that's usually someone who doesn't do well with a desk job, who needs an active vocation, which you do have, I understand, who's usually good with their hands, likes to craft, and or if you aren't active craft, do you do any creative stuff craft-wise?
Yes, I do creative stuff for my kids all the time. I'm a very creative person.
Good, I thought so. Yeah, so that's I sometimes joke and say a woman with that feature knows how to change a plug. You know, you can use your hands in some way.
Yeah. So I have really. You said what now?
Those are the hand shape angles and curves.
Oh, so wow.
Curves and angles and so on that are also relevant, not just what we see in the palm, so to speak.
Oh, wow. So you're really good at what you do.
So, been at it a long time.
Yeah. Well, I really enjoyed all the advice you have gave us today, like from just people realizing like it's just a conscious decision. It's that feeling of purpose. And it could be simple as being the best grandma, the best mom, the best dad or whatever, but it doesn't necessarily have to be this grand thing that we think that we need or we're looking for. So I really feel like that was something that I took away from this that I have never heard anybody say, is that consciousness of the activity or whatever you're doing is really what we all need to think about every single day.
And then for people who cannot have some sort of incredible life purpose because they're disabled or they're...
Yeah.
Elderly or whatever, then that's to aim for the sensation that in that moment sensation of that moment of peace. And in that moment, it's like, and it's another Eilat's second book, which is called you have permission to exist. And in that moment, permission to exist, you're good enough just exactly as you are by virtue of your existence. And that can be enough. If you give it, gift yourself with that, because if you always going on and on and on in your mind around that you don't have a purpose, then that's what you're going to feel. And the thought can be changed into, if I'm cooking a meal for my family, I have permission to exist. I am on purpose in that process.
Oh, I love that. You have permission to exist. It doesn't even matter. And I think that's definitely top of everything, regardless, is that we all need to know that we have permission to exist. And it's that feeling and sensation.
I've just seen also the info from this woman who I've just done the course with last year. Just like to know of her existence as well. She's so divine. Might want to interview her one day. You never know. Another South African.
Well, this definitely has been amazing. You have shared again so much with us. Outside of purpose, what do you feel like you haven't mentioned today that you want to leave us with?
If I may, I'd just like to mention that I do have two wonderful training courses.
Yes.
That if anyone would like to learn more or know more rather about what I offer, then to have a look at my website or to email me, contact me in some way. And so happy just to meet with you on Zoom, even for 20 minutes or so, just by way of a little chat. And or we can talk about what's available in the States. That's another option. In the hand-reading realm, that is. And if anybody wants guidance on what their divine life purpose is through the medium of what I can see in their hands, then of course you're most welcome to schedule a reading with me.
Yeah, definitely. If you don't know, and she could definitely at least get you a kickstart on your path.
We'll narrow it down at the very least.
Yeah, definitely. Well, thank you for being here today. I really have enjoyed you being here with us. Can you tell everybody what your website name is?
So my brand name is God Given Glyphs. So it's one word, God Given, G-I-V-E-N, and then Glyphs. That spells G-L-Y-P-H-S. And of course, the glyph is the fingerprint. So it's www.godgivenglyphs.com.
Okay. And that's where they can find everything about you. And then social media.
Yes. Well, I've got the same Instagram account and the same YouTube channel.
Oh, and wow. Facebook. Okay. So she's on YouTube. So you'll be able to see how beautiful this lady is who's telling me she's about to be 70.
In October.
Oh my God, she does not look 70. So please go look at her YouTube, because she looks like, if she's older, you know, she looks like at least 50. At least. And you look younger than that. You look really young. So you need to, if you're going to go check out her YouTube, at least go check it out and just see how young and you
look. Probably a lot to do with the lighting and the makeup, but thank you. And the joy of just being able to connect with you, you know, that changes energy. Some days I'm pretty sure I look more like 80, but okay. It's hard as <isn't> it?
If you would like to connect with Jennifer, please go check out her website, go check out her social media and her YouTube channel. If you're interested in some of her services, she can also do Zoom in addition. So don't think you have to be where she's at. You can also connect with her via Zoom.
Yeah.
Awesome. So thank you guys for tuning in today. I hope that you found value in today's episode and that you can start living a more purposeful life. all the exercises that we talked about today can really help you get started with living that purposeful life. So make sure you take these exercises and practice them, because that's the only way you're going to know if they work. All right, guys, if you enjoyed today's episode, make sure you share this episode with someone you know. Remember, sharing is caring, and that is how we help each other grow. All right, you guys, thank you again for tuning in today, and I love you guys. Bye.